Hello, hello.
Okay, can everybody hear me? Also in the back? Yeah? Also the guys in the back standing there, can you hear me? Good. Is there anybody who doesn't speak Dutch, by the way? Because I can do it in English, I can do it in Dutch. So there's two of you who don't speak Dutch, sitting way in the back. I'll do it in English, don't worry. Oh, if that's okay with the rest of you then. Can we have a vote? No, don't. I have to do this quickly. I was doing the same talk last night in-house somewhere at a company called Tools Forever in Bayern. And I did the same talk, and it took me 2 hours. So did you all bring your coffee and drinks and stuff like that? Because we're going to be here for quite a while then. Okay. So I only have like 45 minutes. So let's get the show on the road. Actually, I have to tell what this is about. This is about the fact that the world is changing. You all know that. But the world is changing even faster than you think. And as a result, software development is changing. It's changing big time. It's changing beyond agile. It's changing beyond modules, packages, namespaces, whatever you have. It's changing the way teams act. It's also changing the way how companies act. And all of that stuff, I'll try to tell you in 45 minutes. That means I have to leave out all the anecdotes, etc. Otherwise, I'll be here for 2 hours. Anyway, so that's the topic for today. Thank you all for being here. I was driving here this morning, stood in traffic on the A2, and I thought, well, maybe if I have 10 people in the room, because you all want to be desperately demanding new features on SQL Server or whatever product Microsoft has out now, and you're all going to do technical sessions right after this brilliant keynote, and I didn't see it, so I'm not commenting anyway. So, this is me. I'm Sander. I have a hard last name in English, but it does tell you that I'm double object-oriented. Good, right? I like static typing, stuff like that. I do tabs instead of spaces. I'm basically a dad, a sort of independent dad, and I'm an independent as well. I used to work for large companies such as Capgemini, but I'm an independent. My current job is being the CTO for a company that builds software for the insurance market. Before that, I was the CTO of an insurance company called Voldemort Insurances, basically. And before that, I was one of the agile global thought leaders at Capgemini. This is my website, my Twitter tag, my GitHub, which is barely empty, and my email address if you have any additional questions. I did write some books, but I'm not going to explain it to you because most of you will have them, had them in whatever education you had, probably this one. If you're older, then you have this one. If you're newer, you might have seen this one. This is the German edition. It's twice as thick. I don't have to explain that one, I guess. There's an international version as well. It has two additional chapters on enterprise agile and distributed agile. And I could have left them out just saying, don't do this. Don't try this at home. I'm writing two new books, one on microservices and one on basically the topic of today's talk. And the book is now called officially The Continuous Culture. So we changed the title. I'm writing that together with Kim. And she's working on that one. I'm working on this one, basically. So here we go. As you might have noticed, times are changing. Times are changing fast. Faster than you think. Now, I have to do a slide on Moore's Law, of course. Right? You know Moore's Law? You should, by the way. This is Moore's Law, and it says the number of transistors in a dense integrated circuit doubles approximately every 2 years. Now, you might think this is a linear line, and it isn't. Because the y-axis is not. This is exponential, right? It's going really, really fast. Now, you might think, what does this have to do with software development? Well, everything. Basically, it allows us to do more difficult things and more time-consuming things in less time and with less effort and in the memory that you might have available. But this is still machines, right? And it goes much beyond that, because now there is the cloud, of course, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And the next thing is, if you look at inventions, this is cool, right? You should have been here in the when the printing press was invented, like in the 1400s, that is in Europe. In China, they had it a long time ago before that. And it took 200 years before they invented the telescope. The telescope is an iron tube with a number of bold glasses in it, right? That's it. It took 200 years to invent from the printing press. Doesn't have anything to do with it anyway. But as you look at inventions further down the road, what you see is it goes way up there. Also, this is exponential. The world is changing faster and faster. It's not linear, it's exponential, right? That is basically because the possibilities we have, and it started sort of with this, the possibilities we have are growing and growing. Who is old enough to have had one of these? Right? Still a few. Good that you're still here, guys. Oh, by the way, did I tell you I'm just a programmer? A bit of big mouth, though. But so this is the IBM personal computer, the 5150. Very interesting. I had one of these, actually. And the simplest configuration has 16K on board. 16K, guys. You can do that in memory yourself, right? And it used an audio cassette. Most of you will never have seen one of these, actually. Those of you who do, you know you needed a pencil, right? To wind it and rewind it. Right, that's the gesture, right? So, and save data, wow. A floppy drive is optional. Floppy drives, those are the square, rectangular things that you could save stuff on. Sort of like a USB stick, but only flat and square and black. A drive was not supported. A system for home and school with a memory of 64K costed you $3,000. It's cool, right? You could buy the most expensive MacBook for this, I guess. And you got one like this. You actually needed a cart to push it around. But my next PC was a laptop, actually, and it stood up, and you pulled down the keyboard. And the screen was in the computer or something. It was black with green ink on it. That was it, basically. So this is 1981, right? And the fact that we could do this at home changed a lot. Then, in 2006, there was a company that actually sold books that went into venueing something really different. Now, the story behind this, you probably know that story, right? That they needed to they wanted to sell more books at Christmas. And then they needed the hardware to be able to support that. And then they thought, oh, in the rest of the year, we could actually rent this out. That's not true. It's the other way around, actually. They figured out they needed all this space way before. And so they figured out a way that they can actually scale this stuff up. Scale all the infrastructure up. And they invented that. And Jeff Bezos wanted to commercialize that even before the story of Christmas and those kinds of spendings actually came out. So they already had it in place. It came out in 2006, and in 2006, that changed the world. Now, of course, Microsoft followed suit. I still remember being in Redmond at a meeting, and somebody came up and explained to us, I was in the .NET Advisory Council at that point in time, and somebody came up to us and said, you know what, we're going to build data centers. And we were like, what are you doing that for, right? This was before there was Azure. They didn't have a name for it. They didn't have a business model. And then we said, so what are you going to do with that? And he said, yeah, we don't know yet. We just think this will be necessary for earning our next $10 billion. And we said, so how much budget do you have? Right? And we were like, okay, maybe $100,000, a million. He said, $2.3 billion. And we were like, okay. So they made it a success, right? And now, if you look at what now is happening, is that I read this article in a magazine or an online magazine a while ago, and it says, Microsoft wants to solve cancer in the next 10 years. Now, they're not going to solve cancer by themselves, right? It's not they who have the medical knowledge. But what they are doing is saying, by treating cancer like information processing systems, Microsoft researchers are able to adapt tools typically used to model computational processes to model biological ones. What they're doing is they're using their enormous space in hardware, in cycles, CPU cycles, etc., to allow researchers to actually go through all of this DNA material and figure out where cancer comes from. You know, medical diagnosis will change in the next 10 years. Not as a result of this, but as a result of there is a vast computational power that we can apply for this. If you're a doctor and you have to pull a diagnosis on a patient, you can compare it to maybe the 1,000 cases you have in your head. Maybe you can try and look it up on the internet. But if you look at AI, if you look at machine learning, people will be able, or machines will be able to diagnose and compare to way more other patients than you can imagine, like 2 million in 10 minutes or something. As a result, your diagnosis will be much better and faster. Now, most of our professions, even our profession as developers, will change as a result of this enormous computational power. Because in the end, I'm not sure whether that is, most of the stuff that we do, most of the repetitive stuff that we do, writing code actually, although I love it deeply, will actually be done by machines. In the end, right? So that's way after we retired and stuff, but I hope. But it is changing. And if you look at what's happening in the industry, you all know these companies, right? That is, if you're Dutch, so except for the two people maybe in the back speaking English, but so these are all retailers having sort of the same revenues all around. But there's a big difference. The one on the left has all sorts of buildings around the country. They rent them, they have them in their possession, stuff like that. And they employ much more people than the other ones. Also, their website for selling stuff, they only started building that in 2008. That was way too late. They missed the boat. And they went bankrupt, right? Now look at banks as another example. There's a bank in the southern parts of Netherlands. It has like 46,000 people on board, right? They have to feed 46,000 families. There's another bank. I'm sorry if you're a worker. I'm not sure if people are working here, actually. They have like 22,000 people on board. They don't get any Christmas presents last year. That's the story it is. Another bank. So here's ING. This is the bank I bank personally. It has like 14,000 people on board. And they have big revenues, right? These are big, big companies. Now, I visited one of these banks a couple of months ago to talk about Agile. And I was basically talking about two-week cycles. And I was at the hardware department of this particular bank. And you might ask yourself, why do they have a hardware department? Well, they build their own cloud, actually, but you could wonder whether you should do this as a bank. And then somebody said, oh, I can never install my machine XYZ, whatever it was, and plug it all in and arrange everything in the network and blah, 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 in 2 weeks. So 2 weeks is too short. And I'm like, 2 weeks is actually too long, dude. And what are you doing here at a bank installing machines? This is not core business for a bank. Now, there's another bank I bank with, and that's this one. They have 119 people on board the last time I looked, a couple of months ago. Compare that to 10, 20, 40,000 people. And you might say, yeah, but they're still small, and they are. But there's no reason why they shouldn't be as big as the other ones. They do the same things, basically. Now, if you look at the fintech landscape in the Netherlands, there's about, maybe some of you are in this graph. We checked last night and they weren't in there, but they should have been in there. So there's like 3,000 companies, small companies in the Netherlands alone, trying to get into fintech, right? Now, imagine one of these companies builds a banking system with 10 guys, putting it in the cloud, so having no hardware at all, writing it in modern languages like Go or maybe on Node.js or whatever they do, I don't really care, build that in half a year and put it into production. What is the big difference with a large bank, right? A brick and mortar bank. The difference is really big. And they might succeed. In the UK, this is already happening. There are bank companies that have like 10 people on board, of which 8 of them are developers, writing banking systems and having them in production, running on either Azure or AWS, right? That is a big change. Now, those changes will happen. So where are we? We write code, right? And we have been writing code for years and years and decades and decades and decades. And what happened is, in our industry, is basically this. You start off with a basically nice car, somewhere in 1990, with two people on board, and you build something, some niche market, and immediately you get a customer, right? And the customer says, could you also add this? And you think, yeah, we can do that, right? So you add a new feature to it, and that grows and grows and grows. And within a couple of years, you will have 100 clients and 20 developers on board, all writing on the same piece of code. Now, in that case, you continuously have to wonder whether you are adding quality or new features. If you can only spend your time once, so you're only be able to use that time to create better code or to add new features. Now, I've worked for companies for 3 decades, and The request for features is a bit stronger than the request for quality, I can tell you. Which basically means, after some period of time, your code will explode. It will happen on any code base. Because new people come in, people go out, people are starting to use different framework, different languages, use different patterns, etc., etc. The code will change, you'll lose your architecture, and in the end, it go down. Basically a bit like this. You know these guys, right? They have great plans in every episode. In episode one, they build a fireplace out of wood. Great idea. And then, of course, something goes wrong, and they'll add something on top of it. Or maybe say, hey, we can also do this, and they add something different on top of it. In the end of every episode, it sort of goes like this. This is the perfect metaphor, I think, for software development projects. That is the way it is. And in the end, you will end up with code bases like these. This is an actual code count for a company I work for. They have 9 million lines of COBOL, 3 million lines of PHP. Now, I don't want to insult any people, but I'm not sure which one of the two is worse. I was at a conference in London in June, and I made a joke about JavaScript. And apparently, I had 700 JavaScript developers in the room. That was not a good idea. So, basically, where it all goes wrong is dependencies, right? You all know the story of this guy who wrote code in the open source, in the JavaScript open source. And he had one of them, his frameworks was called Qik, K-I-K. And there was a company called Qik. They have a chat program for whatever, I don't know what it's called, some sort of WhatsApp, but different. And they said to this guy, oh, you have to name your framework, you have to give it a different name, because we are also called Qik, and we have big lawyers and big law firms behind us, so change the name. And he said, fuck you, basically, that's what he said. And then he said, well, I'm going to send a lawyer to you. And so he had to change the name. As a result, he pulled all his code from open source. One of the pieces of code he had in the open source was a single method called leftpad. You know the story? Look it up. It's a great story. He pulled that out. Basically, leftpad was used in every major JavaScript framework out there in the world. Which basically meant he pulled it out, and the same day, the builds broke for all of these large JavaScript frameworks, right? Just because one guy pulled 11 lines of code from open source. That is the basis we're all building up, right? This is doomed to go wrong. Now, the thing is, what we need to do is we need to change because we are not fast enough. So everything needs to become smaller and faster and shorter. Basically, that means you will have to change the culture of your company. Of most of your companies, basically. It also means letting go of Scrum. Let it go. Somebody said you have to sing a song, so anyway, so that's my attempt to it. Also, it means that you have to stop doing projects. Projects are wrong, right? When you go home tonight, you talk to your manager tomorrow or maybe the day after. Tell him doing projects is wrong. Send them all to me. I'll have lunch with them and I'll explain it to them, etc., etc. But I'll explain it now as well. Also, it means that your teams will going to get smaller. Who has a team of more than 10 people in it? Nobody does that anymore, right? I have 20 people in my team. It's not because I'm smarter, it's because that's just the way it is. It's just the way it grew, right? But the thing is, teams will get smaller. Who listens to what Scrum says or whoever is in Scrum saying, every team should be 7 plus or minus 2 people? You know that rule, right? Only a few. The rest of you just don't dare to say it. Anyway, I'll talk about that too. We will have less management, right? Power to the developers, basically. That's what's going to happen. Last but not least, we will go and build smaller pieces of software, which is not really easy, actually. I've been doing this for a couple of years now. That's why I'm writing a book about it, and it's hard. But let me start with the first one. Let's start with the culture. Now, this model it's basically written by a Welsh guy called Dave Snowden. He's a professor at Bangor University. And he wrote this model called Kinevan. I hope I pronounced it right. I was in Wales 2 weeks ago, and it's Welsh. And Welsh is a really strange language. So I had to pronounce it in front of a full room full of Welsh people, including the guy who wrote the thing itself. So I was really scared, actually. But it's called Kinevan, and it has four zones. And this zone here is called the simple zone. That is where cause and effect are really close to each other. Basically, you can say, if this is the problem, I'll solve it almost immediately. If I want to write a simple application for a list of telephone numbers for the receptionist, we can all do this, right, in a couple of hours. That's easy. So these problems are all solved already. Now, most of you, actually most of your managers, who of you is a manager, by the way? Oh, good, only two or three or four. Oh, that's okay. So most of the managers of your companies will think that your company sits there. This zone actually says there is a cause, and if you put some analysis on it, you can actually find what comes out. It's a linear connection. It's a linear association between the two, right? So that means basically you could say, oh, I'm going to start up a project, hire some analysts, they'll analyze it, and then we'll be able to program it, and we'll be able to deliver that in 2 years' time, given this functionality with this number of resources. Usually they mean people, but anyway. That's why I've got a sticker on my laptop that says, we're not resources, we're people. So, go to your manager. If they mention the word resource, say that you're a person, right? They have to count it. But, the thing is, it has never been linear. We have never been able to predict right exactly that we'll be there in 2 years' time. Why? Teams change, people change, technology changes even faster. What I explained before. The fact that it changes so fast means that you will not be able to do this. If you look at Dutch government projects, all of them fail. All of them over 10 million fail. Your project's probably under 10 million, right? So they all fail, basically because they take the assumption that you can write a proposal, send it out to some companies, they'll reply to that, stating exactly what they will do in 3 years, and finish it up. That will never happen. Look at the news, right? Look at what happened to Capgemini last weekend. Is anybody of you from Capgemini? They have to work harder now because they have to pay 21 million to the Social Verzekering Bank. Right? They failed the project. But basically, a large part of that is due to the fact that the way the government agencies write out these proposals is doomed to fail. Because we are not there. We are actually here. I should be taller, but that's... Anyway, we're in the space that, you know, cause and effect are somewhere in the same space, but we don't know how to connect these, right? You can say, as a vision, like the vision of the company I work for now, they say, we want to be the connector between all the parties in the insurance market, right? That's pretty vague, and we've done that on purpose, because we will try to get there. We don't know how, and we don't know exactly where we'll end up, because... The only thing we will do is take the next step, we'll probe it, as the model says. We'll sense what happens, and we'll respond to that. Basically changing the direction possibly, or maybe not. But we don't know. So you cannot plan 3 years ahead. You can only plan a very short time ahead, making that precise and concrete. Or everything after that, leave it there. That is changing your perspective on projects, because if you look at the iron triangle saying, oh, we're going to do this on time, on budget, with the required functionality, it is wrong. Kill that, please. It will save you so much time and effort to do that. So you have to start writing these plannings. You have to go to what I call a roadmap or a backlog. Just pick the next item from the backlog or from the roadmap, work on that, and don't go beyond that, because other than that, you don't know what's happening, because the outcome of working on this particular item might change the direction that you're moving in. Take that into account. It's the way it goes. And if you do that, the best way to do that, so I've been working with forming teams and storming and whatever for over 2 decades now, and the thing I found that works the best for the teams that people I work with is to allow them to figure out how to work together themselves. Not a manager that says, you're in that team, and management teams that change teams every 3 or 6 months and move them around the floors where they are, that's horrible. Leave that to the teams, please. And this is an interesting example. This is a square here in Amsterdam. And last year, because the traffic was so dense here, they did an experiment. What they did is they switched off all the traffic lights. They removed all the lines from the street, and they just said, Figure it out yourself. Let it go. I don't know how to sing this song, but anyway, if anybody does, so please do. But and they just let it go. What happened is that people who were used to having automated all these rules on Crossroads, like, oh, the red lights all stop, and I'll look at my phone for like 20 seconds, and the red light becomes green, and I can go on again without looking what's happening in the rest of my environment. Now, people actually crossing the road have to look at what's happening around them, right? They have to look, if you cross the road, even on the zebra path, I couldn't figure out the English word for that in a second, but anyway, so I was thinking, yeah, well, anyway, it doesn't really matter. The thing that's on the Abbey Road album, right? And so if you cross that, you have to look into the car that's coming up to you, to the guy sitting behind the wheel, look in his eyes and see if he's planning to stop, right? If he's not, you'll stop. And if you don't, if you want him to stop, you'll just put your kinder cart in the road and he'll probably stop, right? Interaction. Figuring out how to work this out, how to do this together. Removing the rules, right? That works best. It doesn't mean remove them totally. Like there's companies that actually allow you to figure out how much vacation you need yourself, right? You can do that too. It seems to work for some companies. It doesn't work for all companies. Sometimes it goes off the deep end, but I'll show you that too. So basically, you have to allow your teams to learn continuously about how they work, about the tools they use, about how to work together, in which smaller teams they work together, etc., etc. Let them figure it out themselves, please. So, and you make a learning organization of them. You organize events, like this is one at the company I now work for that's taking place on November 8, I think, or 2 maybe. Would it be a 2 or a 3 or an 8? Anyway, so, where you can teach each other, right? And the thing is, stop doing projects. And I'll go back into that more. So the next step is stop doing projects. Not a surprise, right? It means that if you look at this particular model, you've probably seen this picture before, right? It's a picture by a guy called Henrik Kneeberg, who works for Spotify. But I use it slightly different than he does. Basically, if you look at software development projects, what we do is we say, oh, we have to deliver 100 features, and we'll do that. And we'll deliver all of them, all 100 of them, to the full extent. Because that's how it works. That's how we got to a tool like Microsoft Word with 20,000 features in it, right? Where we only need 10% of that, most of us. So we do that like that. And you can change that. A friend of mine who is a project manager, he used to be a friend, now he's a project manager, and he came up to me and said, oh, I've done another successful project. Actually, he put that on his Facebook. And he said, so I said, what do you mean? He said, well, it's on budget, on time, with the required functionality. I said, how do you know it's successful? And how do you know whether it couldn't have been more successful? And he didn't understand. I'll explain to him. I said, you know what? If you have these 100 features, what you could do is talk to your client saying, we're going to pick the first feature. You pick, and we'll talk to each other. It doesn't mean doing refinements or something like that. It just means talk to each other and saying, okay, what kind of version do you need for this feature? Can we keep it simple and we'll finish it in 2 days? Or do we need the full extent with all the buttons and knobs and an audio system, etc., etc., which also gets you from A to B, but we'll build it in 3 months. Or somewhere in between, right? And they'll probably say, you know what, let's build a simple version of that. Once you've done that after 2 days, you can go back to the client and say, okay, we've done this feature. How do you feel about the next one? What should we do? Should we pick a new feature from the roadmap or backlog or whatever we have? Or should we extend this one? He'll probably say, you know what, we'll pick the next one. So what do you want us to build? Let's build a bicycle for this one. So in the end, you will not have built 100 cars, but you will have built maybe 4 cars, maybe 20 motorcycles or 38 bikes and 50 steps and, well, that's not a step, but and like 25 skateboards, something like that. And doing it like that, it's also cheaper because it takes less time and probably also less people or resources, whatever you prefer. So this is a very different way of looking at it. I taught my teams basically to answer one single question every time a manager, a product owner, a stakeholder, whatever you might have, comes up to you. The only thing you have to say is this. Do we need this now? If you don't need it now, you don't build it. Right? There's no sense in saying, oh, you know what? I'm going to make this more generic because we will be able to use that later. Nobody uses that stuff later, right? Because people later will come up with the same idea. 2 years down the road, somebody will say, we're going to build this generic, not knowing that there's a good dude out there who did that 2 years ago, right? It never happens, so don't do it. I actually banned the word generic from my teams. I said to my team, I'll personally throw you out if you use the word generic. And they're not. I'm not talking about generics, right? That's different, but generic. So basically, if you do this, if you talk about minimal viable products, you can stop doing projects. That's step one. The next step is talking about cycles. The cycles you have will be shorter than the ones you have today. That goes for all of us, basically. Even if you're already deploying once a day. Who deploys more than once a day into production, right? Three of us. That's too little. Let me explain. This is Scrum, right? You know Scrum? Who of you is a certified Scrum whatever? Oh, God. There's always a few. Anyway, I'll explain it really, really briefly. Right, what's happening is you have a backlog, right? That's basically the same thing I had in Robin. Every sprint or iteration, you pick up some items, you split them up, and you start estimating them, right? Who of you does planning poker? Stop doing that. It's a waste of time. I'll explain that. And anyway, you work on that, on those tasks or whatever you call them, and in the end, you will have potentially shippable product increment, whatever that may be. Right? It has to be useful for the client. You know how hard it is to predict every 2 weeks an amount of work that exactly fits those 2 or 3 weeks and is still useful to a client. That is virtually impossible. So change this model, right? And if you are working at a large company, you're probably thinking about, how do we scale this up? We are in an agile transition. Who is? Quit your job, guys. Doesn't work. What do you mean? You're going to do multiple scrums and then have a scrum of scrum? Or worse? This is not very agile. I try to explain that everything becomes smaller and then people come up with this huge model, right? It has a train. The concept of a train in it, a train runs on rails, right? You put the rails from Amsterdam to Utrecht and they will stick there for the next 500 years. That is not very flexible, I would say. And then there's also people who try to implement this model. Who does? Only a few, right? This is a more interesting model. See, you have to sit in a boat or something and race each other. No, I'm just kidding. This is the Spotify model. It's not a bad model, but you are not Spotify. Spotify, unless you are, of course, but Spotify is a company that grows really, 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 really fast, and that streams music. If you're a bank and you copy the Spotify model, you are not going to... I was at a conference in Nyenrode. And I had to do a talk, and right before me was a guy from a particular bank here in Amsterdam. They're actually pretty close from here. And I said, yeah, we're implementing Spotify. And I asked him from stage, he was in the front row, I said, are you also going to stream music then? And he said, no, we're a bank. So if you're a bank with a sort of continuous number of people working for you, why are you trying to copy the model of a company that grows like this and streams music? You are not streaming music. Every one of you have to look which of these models and how to sort of mix and match them together fits your company, right? Don't do it the other way around. It just doesn't work. So the question is, what's the point? Scaling agile shouldn't be your goal. Doing agile projects should be, right? But do them without all the iteration stuff and the estimation stuff. You can leave all those ceremonies out there because they don't add value. Well, they do, but they don't add enough value. For instance, this particular project happened in Brussels. It was a .NET project, by the way, but that doesn't really matter. So this is typically a burn-down charge. You know these things, right? And you should be sort of along the black line that is on average where you should come out with no work at all. This sprint, it didn't work, right? They had work left. Yeah. Right, and then the next one, so they still had some work left. And the third one, and the fourth one, and the fifth one, and the sixth one. Now the project manager got really mad, and he said, you guys are stupid, because you cannot estimate your own work. That's true, we can't. They should have replied that just, that's true. Did you figure that only out after 6 months? And he said, oh, now we have to do 300 points per iteration. And they did sort of like, well, this is the wrong numbers, but they did sort of like 90. And they only had 3 sprints left. Cool project, right? It failed miserably. That was a government project. The thing is, in software development, we are not here to do these mini projects, because basically all of these agile methods still lead to the fact that you're thinking that you are in the complicated world and not in the complex world. This is what the Agile Manifesto says, right? It says, satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of valuable software. That is different than, I'm going to do a sprint and plan that and blah, 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 and still end up in the complicated world. This is what it is about. So you have to move to putting more stuff out there into production every day. You know, in 2014, there were companies that didn't go into production with their software. What do you mean you didn't go into production? What is that, actually? And what you see is that the trend is moving towards shorter and shorter cycles. And there's a good reason for that, because shorter cycles add value. Because they shorten the feedback loop on everything you do. Last Friday, there was one of the product owners came up to me and said, there's a bug in this particular feature that we have. And I looked at it together with a tester. It took her about half an hour to figure it out. I changed the code, the tester looked at the test, it ran, we ran it to the pipeline and put it back into production. And we said to the product owner, go back to the client and say that it's repaired and that he can now use the new feature. Within 2 hours. That's pretty cool, right? And the thing is, it changes the way you write code. Because there's nothing like, oh, we're going to release only once per 3 months, so it has to be perfect. Meaning you spend a whole lot of time integrate testing everything. It doesn't have to. Because you can say, oh, you know what? If something is wrong, we'll fix it and we'll send it out immediately. There is no rollback anymore, right? It changes the way you look at software. And it goes much, much faster, much, much cheaper, actually. So you move into continuous delivery. Now, that's a hype word as well, right? But it basically says this. It's an approach in which teams ensure that every change to the system is releasable. Every change, every time I check in a piece of code, I have all my unit tests ready, of course. We write them all the time, right? I thought so. And you are able to release it into production. Now, that is really changing the subject. That is changing the way we write code. And we move into some sort of continuous flow. Yes, we use Jira. We have to. It's like, but this is basically our flow. It's a bit white now because of the brightness of the screen. But basically, items come in here from the roadmap. We move them through these particular stages in like maybe a day, maybe 2 days. This is new stuff, right, coming in. And we do some design. We build it. We test it. We write the unit test here. And we do some peer review. And it goes into acceptance, and it's done, right? And the only thing we measure, we try to measure, is the time it takes to get an item from here to there. That is all we measure, which basically means that the law of large number now applies. Now I'm going to talk about estimation, right? Estimation. This is the law of large numbers. Remember this for the rest of your lifetime. It's math, right? So it's easy. Impossibility theory. The law of large numbers is a theorem that describes the result of performing the same experiment a large number of times. According to the law, the average of the results obtained from a large number of trials should be close to the expected value. Let me give you an example. In elementary school, I was done early with calculus. So the teacher said, maybe you can do some math. And I said, so what? I don't know what math is. And I figured out an experiment to throw two dice for 10,000 times. I was really bored, right? And I did that. And you can all figure out. And so I sort of wrote it down how many times every number came up. You know what came up most? 7. The magic number, except for 42, though. But and that's not a surprise, right? It didn't surprise me, though. And it was actually, the graph was like that. No surprise, right? Because I did it 10,000 times. So you'll add up to the average. It's the same with software estimation. Right? If you have a scale, let's name it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you estimate 10,000 items on that scale with a team very knowledgeable or whatever, or with t-shirt sizing or whatever you do, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if you estimate 10,000 items, you know what the average value will be, right? It will be around 3. That basically means that if you have enough items to estimate, that you don't have to estimate. You can just count them. Now, how much easier is that? You know, you go into this planning poker session and you say, how many items are we going to estimate? Well, 10. Okay, then the outcome will be 10. Or 30 if you like 3. But That's about it. So there is no reason to do estimation anymore, especially if you go as fast as this. It doesn't make sense because you are not trying to estimate how much work can fit in some period of time. You are only looking at the next item to do and how quickly you can get it through to done. That's about it. Now, that is what continuous delivery is about. Now, this is, again, due to this is, should be green. This is a Jenkins screenshot I took earlier this week. Basically, if I check in my code, this is my current client, right? Basically, if I check in my code, the build runs, the unit tests run. When they're all green, we actually run it through SonarQube to do static code analysis. It looks at cyclomatic complexity, et cetera, et cetera. If Sonar says it's okay, we'll wrap it in a Docker container, put it in Docker Hub, right? From there, it's get deployed to the staging environment. The staging environment we use, and I know it's the wrong term for that, we use it to test our components, our microservices, in isolation. If that works, we'll put it into the test environment. There, we run scenario tests. So if I log into the account component, it checks in the organization component whether I'm actually working there or stuff like that, right? So it's two components combined. From there, it goes into our integration environment, which runs on AWS, basically. There, we test the whole landscape of this company because everything is deployed to that environment. Every build is going there. And we'll test them integrated into end-to-end scenarios, using Cucumber in this case, and we'll test them, and then we'll put them into the acceptance environment, run the performance and load test, and if that's okay, it goes into production immediately, automatically, without anybody touching it, from the moment I check in my code. Now, that is efficient, guys. And we are all going to move into this direction, I can tell you, for sure. So I'll skip this part about testing. Anybody who's a tester? Nobody does that, right? You're a tester? Oh, basically, crap, I have to go back. Sorry. Oh, basically, too much companies do this. They write very, very little unit tests because this is developer stuff. Developers don't like this. Most of you don't like this, actually. And then there's testers writing manual tests in Excel spreadsheets, filling them out into the web forms and checking, yes, this is okay, this is okay. We had one tester doing this, but we continually deployed into the environment she was testing in. So every time we deployed something, her session broke down. So she was in the middle of clicking something and then clicked on the button to move to the next page. There was no next page. And she was like, ah, don't do this. I have to finish my test first. And we said, how long do you take? And she said, half an hour. Well, I said, in half an hour, we will have deployed 6 new versions. Change the way you work. So you have to move it like this, right? That's changing stuff. Okay. And also, as a last part of this piece, is that you will have to change the way you look at infrastructure. Because infrastructure is taking up more and more of our time. You know how hard it is to look at AWS? Have you tried? You can actually hide things in the UI of AWS. I know our code maybe, but so we treat our infrastructure like kitten, right? We'll take it to the vet if it coughs. And we'll pet it, and we'll give it an injection and shut like that, etc. And we'll repair it continuously until it's 15 and dies of old age, right? It's the same with our infrastructure. Don't do this, right? Because it is much cheaper and much easier to write a piece of code, maybe in Groovy or whatever you do, and actually say, you know what, if the machine coughs, we'll kick it out. We'll just puff, and we'll just click a button, run the script, and a new machine, virtually, of course, is standing there, right? It takes like half a minute. That is much easier than continuously patching this stuff. So you have to start treating your infrastructure like cattle and automate everything. Eventually, you come up with this model. Right? Like one-day sprints. I don't like the word sprint at all, by the way. No stand-up meetings. Oh, they take so much time, right? Just talk to each other, build something, agree on it, build it, deploy it, go home, continue working at home, and then repeat the next day, right? This is where we're going to be. And it will not take 5 years before most of you will actually get here. Right? That is pretty cool. In that case, you can stop doing projects. I'm going to do one more because I only have 2 minutes. I'm leave the Microsoft part because I believe during the keynote, microservices was touched more than enough, apparently. So I'll talk a little bit about it. I'll talk about teams a little bit. As I said, less rules make teams better because they have to think about how they work themselves, right? This is a typical stand-up meeting, right? I have to do this basically because my girlfriend's in the picture. And yeah, and there's a guy in a suit, look, a project manager. That's the last one I saw, actually. So that's why I took the picture, basically. But we have to stop doing that, guys. And we have to look at our own working environments. There's companies in the US, like Zappos, who are changing the way work environments look. It's happening in the Netherlands as well. This is my girlfriend's leg, actually, sitting in an interview at a respected retailer in a glass fishbowl with the, I don't know, director of IT for a management position. They're actually sitting like they're in the IKEA. Now, I think, well, this is not my thing, basically. I like a bit of fun. I'm crazy enough myself. So I don't like this. It is basically people saying, yes, you have to adopt a developer culture. This is not developer culture, guys. This is kindergarten culture. Don't overdo it. But the thing is, moving into self-organizing teams, into autonomous teams, is not as easy as it looks, because it always is. Outside of your company, you have to talk to other people. I don't use this slide at Java conferences, by the way, because they run away, just basically. And so this is about autonomous teams. It's people saying, yeah, you have to organize yourselves, you know? I'll explain to you how to draw two circles, and then you draw the rest of the owl, which is hard, guys. And I'll skip a bit of slides, basically. But the thing is that I figured out, and this is basically me coming up to 0 seconds now. Well, my thing starts zooming. Traditionally, you have teams like information analysts, developers, testers, operations people in the basement. And then we moved to Agile, right? And people said, oh, yes, we're going to have multidisciplinary teams, which is much, 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 much better. And still you have them. And what I sensed over the last 5 or 6 years with the teams I worked with is that it's even moving into smaller teams. Sitting inside of a pool of people with different backgrounds and different things to do. My current team is about 20 people. They all sit really close to each other, like in 16 desks that are all standing together. We continually change into smaller teams, and I call that sort of micro teams, of 2 or 3 people, and nobody's telling them how to do this. They just do this. They pick the next topic from the backlog and figure out who is best at doing these. Group together, 2 or 3 people, work together on that, deliver it, and then the next thing comes up, and they change again, right? And it's very organic. That's a cool word, right? Everything has to be biodegradable or whatever, so it's organic. Maybe I should call this organic teams. And this is basically the way my teams have worked over the last couple of years. And I only realized that it's going like this a couple of weeks ago. I think that this is a pattern that works for a lot of companies. I'm not saying it works for all companies, because there is no such thing, but that's basically it. And this is moving into even smaller cycles, right? Into smaller themes. You can go faster and faster and faster. And the last thing should be microservices. I don't have time to do that, actually, because I'm already 1:33 over time. But there's one thing I learned new, is that given sufficient time, any group of the programmers will decide to rewrite your code. It's called Lanva. I just discovered it last week, so I had to put it in. So microservices, going into smaller pieces, is not as easy as it looks, right? If you look at Martin Fowler's really short definition, see, it says in short, there's lots of stuff you have to take into account. You have to take into account that you have to decide how small are these things? Why are they as small as they are? That has to deal with bounded context, but I explained that during my talk here in the room across the hall last year already, right? So, and basically you have to figure out how to do HTTP APIs. There is no rules for that. There are only guidelines coming from companies like Google or Zalando. They have these guidelines. But you still have to look at which status codes are you going to pass back. What is in my JSON object? Is it just the object itself? No, maybe you can wrap it in something, stuff like that. You have to figure that out. You have to figure it out how to create pipelines, how to deploy your software, how to create independently deployable parts. And then there's always the discussion. If you already have a monolith, should you move to microservices? And the answer is not always yes. It depends on the goals that you are trying to reach. But new software that you are building, please build it in very small parts, into very small namespaces, packages, modules, whatever you might, units, whatever you might do, right? Build them in small parts. And we're going to be even smaller, right? We're going to move into individual functions. There's probably a lot of talks about this topic already. Serverless computing, which doesn't mean serverless computing. It just means computing on somebody else's server, right? It's not serverless anyhow. But remember, there's one thing to remember and to take into account, is that these are all distributed systems. And distributed systems are really hard by nature, because there is no such thing as a rolling back a database transaction. There is no single database. Every component has its own database. You cannot roll back stuff. You have to look into things like eventually consistency, stuff like that. But please remember, moving towards small components, small pieces of software, which are much easier to build and much easier to test in any language you like, as long as it does HTTP, you're good. Right? And then again, you can stop doing projects. Conclusion. We have been, oh, sorry, was I too quick? Oh, sorry, can I go back to what I, oh, wrong button, sorry. Oh, I'm getting nervous. You mean this one, right? One back. Oh, one, this one. Stop sign, oh, stop sign is here. Oh, it's gone. What a crap talk this is, right? Anyway, let's wrap up. Look at this model. Show it to all your managers. Explain to them that they have been thinking wrong for 50 years in this field. We are in the complex area, not in the complicated one. That means don't do any projects anymore, because things like waterfall and Scrum is only a bunch of small waterfalls. Most people do that, still thinking that you're in the complicated space and that you can plan your project. Doesn't work. Stop doing that. Right. That's basically my last slide. I'm 5 minutes over time exactly, which is my goal. And so here's my reference data. I'm probably here for the rest of the day, drinking lots of water because I have a really dry mouth. Have a great conference, and thank you for being here.